So much. Good morning and welcome. So last week we had a power outage, and we don't have a recording of last week's message, and last week's message became a little bit abbreviated. We didn't want to stay in here too long, as the heat was steadily rising. So we broke apart last week's message in two. Last week I covered Romans chapter 10, verse 18, through the conclusion of that chapter, and into Romans chapter 11. We looked at, you know, the first 14 or so verses of Romans chapter 11 last week. I won't go into all the details of that, but I will certainly say, just as a reminder to those who were here, and a note to those who were not able to be here, we did see at the conclusion of Romans chapter 10 that Paul cites Isaiah, lamenting that not all have obeyed the good news, highlighting Israel's stubborn unbelief despite God's wonderful outreach to them. We can look at the end of Romans chapter 10. You can see the words there that Paul uses. And of course, there's already been the importance of the word and those who need to go out into the world to preach the word so that people may hear the good news, and how beautiful are the feet of those who bring the good news, we read in Romans chapter 10, verse 15. But it does say in verse 16 of Romans chapter 10, not all the Israelites accepted the good news. For Isaiah says, Lord, who has believed our message? And then, of course, consequently, faith comes from hearing the message, and the message is heard through the word of Christ. But I ask, did they not hear? Well, the answer is, of course they did. And he cites Moses, and he cites Isaiah. He is citing Moses, representing the law, right? And Isaiah, representing the prophets there. First Moses says, verse 19 of Romans chapter 10, I will make you envious by those who are not a nation. I will make you angry by a nation that has no understanding. And then verse 20, Isaiah boldly says, I was found by those who did not seek me. I revealed myself to those who did not ask for me. But concerning Israel, he says, verse 21, that final verse of Romans chapter 10, all day long I have held out my hands to a disobedient and obstinate people. And so, you know, we looked at last week at the beginning of Romans chapter 11, and there Paul begins asserting that God has not rejected his people completely, citing his own Israelite lineage there as evidence. And you remember that you can see in the beginning verses there of Romans chapter 11, he brings up the time of Elijah, when God had preserved a remnant of 7,000 who had not bowed the knee to Baal. And similarly, at this present time, there is a remnant chosen by grace. This is a remnant, you know, it has nothing to do with what they have done, in the past or are doing presently, or what they will do. Rather, this is a remnant that's chosen by grace. It's God's graciousness that's the key. It's not by works. So, and then Paul explained that Israel's transgression and then their consequent partial hardening, that partial blinding led to salvation for the Gentiles in order to provoke Israel to jealousy. And we caught some of that right there in those words that Paul was quoting there. But to provoke them to jealousy because of all the spiritual riches that the Gentiles now have in Christ. It's meant to stir them, Paul says, to a sort of envy and jealousy that they would want this. They would seek this as God's people. And so I can read a little bit of that, and you capture this in Paul's words in Romans chapter 11, if we were to look back at verse 12. Romans chapter 11, verse 12. But if their transgression means riches for the world, and their loss means riches for the Gentiles, how much greater riches will their fullness bring? Paul is considering. I'm talking to you Gentiles, verse 13, inasmuch as I am the apostle to the Gentiles. Oh, how that would have stirred something within the Jewish people. The apostle to the Gentiles, he says. I make much of my ministry in the hope that I may somehow arouse my own people to envy and save some of them. Right? You know, that they would come to know Christ as their own. For if their rejection, verse 15, is the reconciliation of the world, what will their acceptance be but life from the dead? I mean, just amazing. And I do want to pick up there this morning. He's saying if the Jews' rejection of Jesus has brought blessings, riches to the Gentile nation, spiritual riches. Just think, Paul's saying, of what the worldwide blessings and that there'll be when the Jews accept Jesus. And we talked about this last week, and Paul's argument concerning this, that Israel's rejection is not total, right? And Israel's rejection is not final. Paul was arguing this, as we saw last week in the beginning verses of Romans chapter 11. And he's saying all of this to make it very clear that there's a future for Israel. There's a future for God's chosen people. Today, Israel is fallen spiritually, but when Christ returns, the nation will rise again. Today, Israel's cast away from God, but one day, someday, we don't know when, they shall be received again. We know this because the Bible tells us so. And God will never break his covenant with his people. Never. And he's promised to restore them. The Word of God says over and over. I did want to share with you some words from the prophet Jeremiah. Jeremiah chapter 31, verses 35 through 37. Listen to these wonderful words of promise from Jeremiah. Jeremiah chapter 31, beginning in verse 35. This is what the Lord says. He who appoints the sun to shine by day, who decrees the moon and the stars to shine by night, who stirs up the sea so that its waves roar, the Lord Almighty is his name. Those things are set. He's the creator and he's the sustainer of the universe, right? This is what he has. You know, he's appointed the sun to shine by day, the moon and the stars to shine by night, the seas to stir up, the waves to roar. This is his name, Lord Almighty. Only if these decrees vanish from my sight, declares the Lord, will Israel ever cease being a nation before me. This is what the Lord says. Only if the heavens above can be measured and the foundations of the earth below be searched out, I will reject all the descendants of Israel because of all they have done, declares the Lord. You know, what a promise this was to the Israelites in captivity, right, at that time. And, you can see as you go through Romans chapter 11, maybe specifically verse 29 later on, that seems to refer to these wonderful words. But those words in Jeremiah, God makes the continuance of the very laws of nature a pledge of the continuance of Israel as a people. They are his people. He has said so, and he stands by his word. He never changes, and he keeps his promises. He keeps his covenants. So from looking to the future, Paul then considers the past to show Israel's heritage. So, we know from the beginning that Israel was a special people set apart by God. So Paul uses an illustration to prove that God is not finished with the Jewish people. He says in verse 16 of Romans chapter 11, if part of the dough offered as first fruits is holy, then the whole batch is holy. If the root is holy there at the end, so are the branches, which will lead into the verses that follow. But, you know, if part of the dough offered there as first fruits, if that's holy, well, then the whole batch is. And this is a reference to what you can read in Numbers chapter 15, verses 17 through 21. And it's actually probably a reference to maybe what we read in the book of Leviticus as a portion of the first fruits given. But, you know, but it's where we see that part of the dough was to be offered up to God as a symbol that the entire batch, the entire lump belonged to God, right? And the idea is that when God accepts the part, he sanctifies the whole. He sets apart the whole. So God had accepted Abraham, right? You know, and Paul's referenced Abraham, and God has accepted him. Abraham, the founder of the nation of Israel. And in so doing, he set apart his descendants as well, is what the word of God tells us. God also accepted the patriarchs. He accepted Isaac, and he accepted Jacob, and he accepted them despite their sins and despite their failings, didn't he? And this means that God must accept, as Paul is saying here, the whole batch. You know, he's going to accept the nation of Israel. And then Paul illustrates then how the Gentiles have been blessed through this nation of Israel whom he accepts. So, you know, again, looking at the last part of verse 16, if the root is holy, so are the branches, flowing into verses 17 and the first part of verse 18. Look at the analogy that he uses. If some of the branches have been broken off and you, though a wild olive shoot, have been grafted in among the others and now share in the nourishing sap from the olive root, do not consider yourself to be superior to those other branches. So the Gentile nations are described as that wild olive shoot. So that wild olive shoot, meaning those Christian Gentiles who believed in the Messiah. But the natural olive tree there in the analogy refers to Israel. It refers to those who've inherited all the promises of God and that covenant of promise, right? So now some of the branches, we read of this natural olive tree, they've been broken off. That is, you know, unbelieving Jews have been taken away out of the promises by their own unbelief. But they've been taken away so that some of the branches of a wild olive tree, right, Gentile branches who believe in the Messiah, in order that they may be grafted in. That's the picture. That's what Paul's illustrating there. You know, in verse 18, they look at it again. Paul says, do not consider yourself to be superior to those other branches. If you do, consider this. You do not support the root, but the root supports you. That's important, right? Gentile believers, Paul's saying, should not despise the Jewish people because Israel and her promises are the root, that root that supports the Gentile branches. You'll remember that Jesus on one occasion was talking to a Samaritan woman, right? Gospel of John, chapter 4. And do you remember what he said? Well, he said many things to her, but he said, salvation is from the Jews, right? John chapter 4, verse 22, the second part of verse 22. Salvation is from the Jews. So Israel were God's elect people to bless the whole world, a nation that came into existence to be that missionary nation to the world, and also to be that vehicle to bring the Messiah, to deliver the Messiah, to be the Savior of the world. And that's what Jesus meant when he said to that woman, salvation is from the Jews. You know, if we're going to be saved, right, as Gentiles, you know, we're grafted into the natural olive tree in place of the branches of unbelieving Jews who've been broken off. is what Paul's telling us there. So, you know, Paul points out a warning in the verses that follow. If you look at verses 19 through 22 of Romans chapter 11, look at Paul's warning. And he's given part of that warning already in verse 18. Do not consider yourself to be superior to those other branches. You know, you have to consider it. You know, you don't support the root, but the root supports you. Verse 19, you'll say then, branches were broken off so that I could be grafted in. Granted, right? In other words, this is true. But, it continued, but they were broken off because of unbelief, and you stand by faith. You stand by faith. Do not be arrogant, but tremble. For if God did not spare the natural branches, he will not spare you either. That's the warning. Consider, therefore, in other words, trust. You know, consider the kindness and the sternness of God, that strict justice of God, sternness to those who fell, but kindness to you. He's saying, trust in that kindness, right? You know, provided that you continue in it. Continue in it. Have faith. Trust in that kindness, those tender mercies. Otherwise, you also will be cut off, Paul says at the end of verse 22 of Romans chapter 11. So Paul is just saying that unbelief is the reason why Israel was broken off. You know, those branches were broken off and they were cast away because of unbelief. Paul's established that. And now he's turning to the Gentiles. And he's saying to the Gentiles, he's saying to them, you've been grafted in place of those Israelites who have not believed. However, beware. You know, be warned, because you could be cut off as Gentiles for the very same reason. You could be cut off for unbelief. You know, just as the Jews did not believe and were cut off, so for the same reason you can be cut off. And so, you know, we remember now, and I've mentioned this over these weeks. Remember, we're speaking corporately. We're speaking collectively. Of the Jews and the Gentiles. God's talking about nations. You know, he's not talking about individual salvation here. And you remember back in Romans chapter 1 that Paul addresses the nations. He's addressing the group collectively, and he says that if nations continually harden themselves against God and suppresses the knowledge that they have of God, he warned them already. That what God will do is he'll cut them off. He'll cut them off. He'll give them up. He'll give them over. He'll give them over to everything, to everything that they want, right? You know? But, you know, it's a principle that Paul's already, you know, espoused right there at the very beginning of the book. And he's saying, Gentiles, just be warned. You've received the gospel. You've received it because of the fall of Israel. But if you don't believe in the gospel as Gentile nations, you're going to be cut off. So just be careful. Be warned of hardening your own hearts against God. And certainly it's a warning to us as Gentiles, as believers today, you know, in the present, that, you know, personally, you know, may apply it to yourself personally. We don't want to reject him. We shouldn't reject him. Why would we reject him? You know, as we see so many around us doing so. Romans chapter 11, verses 23 and 24. These verses really speak of how unbelief just cut off the Jewish people. But now Paul says, if they could believe, right? If they should believe, they'll be grafted in again. You know, and again, this is speaking not of individuals, right? This is speaking nationally. You know, we're still looking at this group collectively as a nation. Paul was an example in his own day of Jews believing, and so was so was the remnant, for that matter. And of course, we know that there are Jewish people who are believing today, praise God, who are benefiting from all the blessings of salvation. But this is speaking of how nationally, you know, if the Jews embrace their Messiah, that they'll be grafted in again. So let's look at them. Verse 23 and 24, Paul says, And if they do not persist in unbelief, they will be grafted in. And I love this. For God is able to graft them in again. That's beautiful, right? After all, if you were cut out of an olive tree that's wild by nature and contrary to nature were grafted into a cultivated olive tree, how much more readily will these, the natural branches, be grafted into their own olive tree, right? I mean, it seems impossible in a way. You know, it's like, well, is this certain? You know, well, yeah, look at verses 25 and at least the first part of verse 26. Look what he says. I do not want you to be ignorant of this mystery, brothers and sisters, so that you may not be conceited. Israel has experienced a hardening in part until the full number of the Gentiles has come in. And in this way, all Israel will be saved. So this isn't some sort of conjecture about what would happen in all possibility, you know, if Jews believed in their Messiah. Not at all. Rather, this is prophetic. This is beautiful. This is the promise of restoration to Israel. And so, therefore, Paul is exhorting, the Gentiles, look, don't boast. Don't gloat over the fact that Israel has fallen in unbelief and you're believing in the Gentile nations. Nor, for that matter, should you proudly assert that they're cut off from God forever, right? Don't, in your pride, do that. No. No, and Paul says, I'm going to reveal to you a mystery, right? And a mystery in the Bible, is just a truth that's been previously obscured or hidden. Maybe a good example of that is, the church. Right, the church is a truth like that. It was never known in the Old Testament, but then the church is revealed through the apostles and through the Lord Jesus Christ in the New Testament. If that helps at all, but Paul says, here's a mystery: Israel's blindness is in part, right? Yeah, their unbelief now is only until the fullness of the Gentiles has come in. So the blinding of Israel as a nation, he's saying, is what he's been saying. It's neither total nor final. It's partial. It's temporary, right? And that means that when the number of believing Gentiles is complete, right? When this present age is just done and it's run its course, and the fullness of the Gentiles has come in whenever, and that's, God's determined time, right? Then, and only then, will Israel's eyes be opened. Then they'll be awakened, right? And in this way, Paul says, all Israel will be saved in that sense. And the reason why Paul shares this mystery is because he says that if Gentiles misunderstand this mystery, what are they going to do? Well, all they're going to do is just boast, over their gain, and they're going to boast, over the Jews' loss. So they can't misunderstand this mystery. And neither should we. There are some people who misinterpret this passage of Scripture. There's people who will wrongly use the term spiritual Israel, out of context. And in other words, they'll use that term suggesting that concepts related to, the error of replacement theology. Replacement theology just teaches that the church has replaced Israel in God's plan, and that the many promises that God made to Israel are fulfilled in the church instead. It means that Old Testament prophecies, people will take that and they're allegorized in order to make them applicable to the church. And no, we can't do that, right? you know, replacement theology just has huge problems. It's because of what we're looking at here in Romans chapter 11. We see very clearly in Romans chapter 11 that God has not forgotten or changed his promises to Israel. So teaching, that promotes a spiritual Israel in the sense that the church is the focus of God's prophetic promises for Israel, that's just not biblically valid. The only spiritual Israel is that believing remnant that's existing now. There's probably moments where you could use the term spiritual Israel in a sense that doesn't present a problem. I guess it all depends on context. If you're using that term, if it's reflecting like, 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9, is using words that we see in Exodus chapter 19 in reference to Christians, right? Maybe that's in a sense, Peter there is saying you're a chosen people, a royal priesthood, right? A people belonging to God, who are meant to, just lift up those praises to the very one who's called us out of darkness and into his beautiful, his marvelous, his wonderful light, right? So maybe in that sense, the term doesn't present a problem. But if you use it out of context, maybe even, now I'm going on a trail here. Stop me. But, maybe even in the, Paul himself will sometimes, sometimes he uses the term Israel in a very literal sense. We've seen that over and over again here in Romans and the book of Romans. When he speaks of Israel, he's speaking of it literally, nationally, as a nation. Other times, like in the book of Galatians, very clearly he's speaking of it in a spiritual sense, right? And we're kind of included as everyone just believing in Christ as a Savior, as a deliverer. Anyway, that's just an aside. That's a bonus. Enjoy that. But anyway, we have to get back to this. The point is that God has not forgotten, and God has not changed, his promises to Israel at all. He keeps his word, and we don't want to misunderstand this. We don't want to misinterpret this as some people do. And we should not at all, take those promises that are for Israel, clearly for Israel, and try to make them, the church. It's just not the same. So please be careful. But let's look again. Verses 25 and 26. I went off. We need to remind ourselves. Verses 25 and 26. I do not want you to be ignorant of this mystery, brothers and sisters, so that you may not be conceited. Israel has experienced a hardening in part until that full number of Gentiles has come in, and in this way, all Israel will be saved. So, is Israel rejected for good? No, Paul says, not at all. Just as now the nation generally, as a whole, has rejected the Messiah from this, apart from that one faithful group of believers among the Jewish people, a remnant according to the election of grace, right? That remnant chosen by grace. So then in a future day, the nation as a whole will accept their Messiah, is what he's saying. So Paul quotes the prophets Isaiah and Jeremiah in the second part of verse 26 and going into verse 27. And he's showing very clearly that God still has a plan for Israel. He hasn't forgotten them. He hasn't rejected them completely. As it is written, second part of verse 26, the deliverer will come from Zion, and he'll turn godlessness away from Jacob, and this is my covenant with them when I take away their sins. He hasn't he hasn't cast them off. He foreknew everything about them. Where do we see that? Verse 2 of Romans chapter 11, or verse 3. He foreknew everything about them, right? Everything. He had his prophets predict it, And one thing is absolutely certain. God will never, ever, ever, ever dishonor his word. Right? Never. His word is at stake. Verses 28 and 29 tell us there. Romans chapter 11, beginning verse 28. As far as the gospel is concerned, they are enemies for your sake, but as far as election is concerned, they are loved on account of the patriarchs. For God's gifts, this is beautiful, by the way, for God's gifts and his call are irrevocable. Right? That's beautiful. When God promises something unconditionally, he will fulfill it. He foreknew Israel and he gave his promises. And if Israel has been condemned to extinction and has no future, then what does that mean? That means that God's dishonored his word. And God never dishonors his word. Never. So trust what the word says. You know, there's a future. There's a future there. And it's really, you talk about a complete history, right? Romans chapter 9 teaches us of Israel's past election. We looked at that. Romans chapter 10 teaches us of their present rejection through their own unbelief, right? And then we're seeing in Romans chapter 11 their future restoration. I think Israel is the only nation in the world with a complete history. Look at this. Past, present, and future. Look at that. It's amazing. Verse 29 tells us why. It's because the gifts and the calling of God are irrevocable, right? That's wonderful. God has not changed his mind concerning the covenants that were made with the patriarchs. And, you know, now Israel may not presently enjoy those gifts. They may not necessarily embrace the privileges, right? The call. However, that doesn't take away anything from the fact that God's word never changes. Whether they enjoy it or embrace it or not, God's word stands, and that's that. You know, if you want to know that God is for Israel, and, I'm not saying, please don't, I'm not saying that, you know, everything they do is right, right? We know this. It doesn't take long. You can clearly look at Israel today in our present time, and we certainly don't have to agree with everything they do politically or militarily, right? Far from it at times. But if you want to know that God is for them, you know, it doesn't change the fact that he's still for them. All we need to do is see their existence today, right? All we need to do is to look at the very fact that they're a nation today, you know, which is most likely a fulfillment of prophecy to the day when they will, as a nation, embrace Christ and Jesus will come. You know, it's just amazing. And it means that Jesus is coming, surely he's coming soon, sometime. It draws near. When? Who knows? I don't know. You know, but he will return no matter what. That is certain. Remember, friends, that Romans chapter 9, chapter 10, and chapter 11, they're following on from those wonderful thoughts and incredible words that we read in Romans chapter 8, where believers, both Jew and Gentile, we're asking there in Romans chapter 8, you know, look, if God hasn't honored his promises to Israel, how can we know that he's honored his promises to us too? You say that we're secure in Christ, but how can we even know? Right? And what Paul's saying here is he is true to all who believe. He's true to Jew and Gentile. He's true to all who believe. Why? Because that's our God. That's his nature and that's his character. Our God says it. He means it. He does it. He keeps his word. Always. Always. God must keep his word, for he is unchangeable. All right? He said it himself. Romans chapter 11, verses 30 and 32. Romans chapter 11, beginning in verse 30, says, just as you who were at one time disobedient to God have now received mercy as a result of their disobedience, so they too have now become disobedient in order that they too may now receive mercy as a result of God's mercy to you. For God has bound everyone over to disobedience so that he may have mercy on them all. I mean, who else but God could engineer a plan like this? I mean, you look at this whole plan, everything that we were looking at last week, and throughout these weeks, really. But these are his chosen people. These are his elect people. And that his elect people would just fall into unbelief so that the gospel would absolutely go out to the nations in order to make his elect people jealous again that they might believe and embrace the Messiah. And then he comes through the world and he reigns through all the nations. What a plan. It's perfect. You know, the God who he foreknew Israel, right? That they should use their fall. He would use their fall for that world redemption. And in light of that, you know, the obvious response of Paul and hopefully the obvious response of us here today, it should be wonder and love and praise. Look at the words there. Look at these wonderful words. Verses 33 through 35 of Romans chapter 11. Oh, the depth of the riches of the wisdom and knowledge of God. How unsearchable his judgments and his paths beyond tracing out. Who has known the mind of the Lord? Or who has been his counselor? Who has ever given to God that God should repay them? You know, God is the source. God is the means and the end of all things. He's the creator and he's the sustainer and he's the goal of everything. And he should be, as Paul said, he should be praised forever. Forever. Verse 36 simply means, it simply says, for from him and through him and for him are all things. To him be the glory forever. Amen. You know, praise is to be our response. But then it's not our only response. Let me just give you quick that first verse of Romans chapter 12. We're going to conclude. But Romans chapter 12, this is also our response. Praise, of course, and then, therefore, as Paul says, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, right, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. What mercy of God? The cost of our salvation. That's what we see there, right? You know, not just Christ's death and his resurrection, but what did we say last week? But what it cost the elect people of the Jew. I mean, this is God's elect people, his chosen people. Their unbelief is the reason why we're here. You know, is the gospel going out to Gentile nations? It's incredible. What a cost. The blessing that's just gone out to us. But, you know, what does that require of us? Well, like Romans 12:1 says, that we present our bodies as a living sacrifice that's holy and pleasing to God, which is our true and proper worship, our service, our duty, is what it is. So do we praise him? You know, maybe as we bring this to a close this morning, you know, the questions to our hearts, do we praise him? We should. Our hearts should be full of praise and love and wonder and awe, just ready to praise him for all he is, for all he's been, for all he will be. He's unchangeable. He's unshakable. You know, he is Almighty God, the creator and sustainer of all things. Do we praise him? You know, do we give ourselves to him wholly? You know, body, soul, spirit, all things over to him. You know, we should have a passion and a desire within our hearts to do so. We have a responsibility to respond. And you know, what's that response? The response is the same for, believer and unbeliever. It's the same response. You know, we have to embrace Christ by faith. Have to do that, and we have to give our all to him because he is worthy, And also, you know, God has planned it so. So I hope, you know, a lot of interesting text and, you know, portions within this chapter, within these chapters, Romans chapter 9 and 10 and 11, but hoping that it'll stir us again within our hearts to continue to live by faith, to walk in the Spirit, but urge us too to keep proclaiming God's name to all. We're not ashamed of it. We just need to continue to carry this good news, and some will believe, others won't. We have our responsibility to continue to worship Him, and to praise Him, and to carry this wonderful news wherever we go. So let's go to the Lord in prayer as we close today. Well, Lord, we just want to thank you so much for this wonderful word that you've given to us. It's hard at times, Lord, to understand exactly what Paul's speaking of, what he might be referring to. Maybe, Lord, it's just, maybe sometimes it's just enough to just sit back. Thinking about even maybe verse 15 today, just kind of take it in, and, you know, the wonder of it all, just amazing. But we thank you for it, and pray that you'll help us continually to apply these things as we're able to our lives presently, our walk with you presently, just recognizing the cost of what's brought us here, what's brought the gospel, the good news to us. That we should certainly continue to carry that good news to everyone. Lord, give us strength and courage to do it. Lord, help us not to, forget or, the cost of all of this. That temporary putting aside of your own people to bring us in, and it's remarkable. My feeble brain, it's really hard, Lord, at times, just wrap around this incredible plan, but to know that it's your sovereign choice and you are in control of everything. All of this is just absolutely remarkable, and it's encouraging. Lord, I pray that your church would be ready to welcome those who believe, and to continue to just reach out and with power and with passion, proclaiming the good news that you've given us. May we continue to shine bright as your people. May we continue to stand out as a peculiar people, as those who are set apart, those who belong to you. Let that mean something. Let us live it. Show it, in our words and our deeds. Let it be an outflowing from what we believe in our hearts concerning you. We trust, Lord, that you'll be with us, not only this day, but all these days ahead. Guide us, Lord, in wisdom, and Lord, equip us with all that we need for the purposes that you've called us to. In Christ Jesus' name, that precious name, that name that's above all names, we pray and we thank you. And amen.